Okay, welcome to this week's Bible class. Last Sunday's Gospel was from Luke chapter 1. And the first reading last Sunday was from Nehemiah number 8, which we have in the notes here. It's a wonderful meditation on the Word of God. How the Jews, having come back from exile, they were hungry for the Word of God. They were so hungry for the Word of God. So, Nehemiah 8 says, Nehemiah was working with a priest. The priest is called Ezra. Yes. Ezra. E-Z-R-A. So Ezra was the priest who was working with Nehemiah, who was a royal official. So they were so hungry for a word, so they asked Ezra, bring the books. We want to hear the word of God. And by the way, that book that they were trying to hear about and they were trying to read and proclaim is from the book of Deuteronomy. The book of Deuteronomy is the fifth book of the Bible. It's part of the Pentateuch. The first five books, Penta means five. The first five books is book of Genesis, book of Exodus, book of Numbers, book of first five books, Leviticus, and then Deuteronomy. Those are the first five books of the Bible. You can see it here too. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. You see those? Those five. And Deuteronomy was the book that was read and proclaimed to the people. Looking at this, the Babylonians conquered Israel in 587 BC. 587 BC, and having conquered them, guess what the Babylonians did? No, we will stay in your place and I want you to go to Babylon. And we'll put you all in jail, put you all in exile. And how long were they in exile? How long?
80 years.
80 years. So the Jews were in exile in Babylon for 80 years. In 507 BC, the Persians conquered the Babylonians. So the Babylonians conquered the Jews, they were put in exile in Babylon, and then the Persians came and conquered the Babylonians. And guess what? King Cyrus. Cyrus was the name of the king of Persia at the time, and he allowed the Jews to return to the promised land. So that ended the exile. Now one interesting note is this. They were in exile for 80 years. How many years is one generation? 40 years. So in other words, those who went to exile in Babylon have already died. They've already died. So those who came back were their descendants already. Because it's two generations after. Interesting though. Two generations. And one of them was Nehemiah. Nehemiah was the prophet, and he wrote this in his chapter 8 of his book. Now, Nehemiah was a Jewish royal official, and he was with Ezra. Ezra was the priest. And they led the Jews to three things: spiritual renewal, purification of exile, and the discovery of lost sacred books. In this particular case, lost means severely neglected. Sounds familiar. How many households neglect the Bible? Many households. Majority of the households don't read the Bible. Majority. And some of them Catholics. So that lost sacred books means they were severely neglected. That's the deep meaning of lost sacred books. Now, it's almost like if you were in jail, you were held up in prison for 80 years. 80 years is a long time. If you enter the jail at 20 years old, you'll be 100 years old before you get released, right? Now, if and when you get released from prison, what do you normally long for first? The freedom outside. The freedom to go around, right? Freedom to go around, freedom to maybe eat what you want, right? And to socialize with people, which you couldn't do while inside the jail. And that's exactly what happened to the Jews. They were in exile and they were not allowed to worship. Imagine. They were people of God, chosen people of God, and they were not allowed to worship in Babylon. In fact, many of them became pagans, because some of them turned into false gods to worship, because they were not allowed. And the Babylonians were pagans. The Jews were made to worship false gods. Now, so the minute they're back in Jerusalem, their task was to rebuild the city of Jerusalem, because the Babylonians have really destroyed most of the things in Jerusalem. They have ransacked the city to its bearers. You know what I mean? They burned books. The sacred places were abused by the people, by the Babylonians, and they were desecrated. They were desecrated. The temple was desecrated by the Babylonians. And that's what happened. So when they were back in Jerusalem, the first task would be to rebuild the city, to rebuild the temple. And that was the idea of Nehemiah. I'm giving you the whole history of the book of Nehemiah. Nehemiah wanted, and he was talking to people, let's go build a temple. We must work together so the temple can be rebuilt, because the Babylonians have destroyed the temple. And that was the first time. Remember, in 70 AD, it was destroyed again. To this day. Now, so that was Nehemiah's and Ezra's idea. Let's rebuild the temple. But it was so difficult. Why was it so difficult? Because many of the Jews who came back from exile from Babylon, they were not as close to God as they were before. They were not as passionate, as dedicated to God as they used to be. Some of them have changed. That's what happens, man, in time. Now, but there were few who were hungry for the word of God. So they wanted spiritual renewal. When there's that, remember the accident in Connecticut last month? Remember that? Newtown? There were counselors. There were counselors available to counsel the children and the adults. What do you think is that counseling about? It could be. That counseling could be so they could better realize what just happened and make sense of what just happened. And that's what this is. Spiritual renewal. Nehemiah and Ezra wanted the chosen people to go back to God. Go back and worship the true God again. You have been 80 years. 80 years is a long time. Imagine not going to Mass for 80 years. What will happen if you don't go to Mass for 80 years? Even if you're still alive.
Even 8 years.
Maybe you'll forget, right? You will lose your connection. Yes? And that's what happened to the Jews.
And you will listen to Mass too.
They lost all the connections. They lost all the familiar things that they were used to doing. So a spiritual renewal, and then purification of the exile, because they made themselves dirty. So they had to be purified. The exiles needed to be purified. And that's what happened. And then we destroy many of the lost sacred books. What does that mean? If you haven't read the Bible in years, maybe one good idea would be to start reading it again. Right? So in other words, if you have neglected it for so long, that's a lost book. That's a lost book. You've got to rediscover that book. That's the thing about the Bible. When you stop reading it, you know what? You lose it. You lose it. the expression, snooze and you lose. When you snooze, you sleep, you ignore, you just don't do it, you stop doing it. Then you lose it. It's just like any skill. Dancing, like dancing. If you don't use it, you forget. Yes? You forget. Does it make sense? Now, with all this background, it brings us to the most important core of last Sunday's gospel. Remember, Nehemiah 8 is all about the Word of God. The people were saying, proclaim the Word of God to us. We want to hear the Word of God again. It's been 80 years. 80 years is a long time. Right? If you are removed from your place and then implanted someplace else for 80 years, what do you think will happen? You'll get adjusted to that new place. After 80 years? Oh yes. If you're still alive, 80 years is a long time. But that's why it doesn't have to be 80. 10 years. Like us, we live here. If you go back to where you came from, you needed some adjustments again. Because you're so used to the life here. Right? The same exact way. So they were clamoring for renewal. And they were hungry. They were hungry for the Word of God. Remember Psalm 119? Psalm 119 is the longest psalm in the Bible. Of the 150 psalms, Psalm 119 is the longest. And you know what is the shortest? The one before that. And these three, the question is, what about you? What about me? Are we hungry for the Word of God? I guess one reason we're here is because we're hungry for the Word of God. Because if we're not hungry for the Word of God, there's no reason to come here. You agree? There's no reason to come here. Because all you hear here is the Word of God. So if you're not clamoring for the Word of God, why bother coming? Now let's look at the verses here. This is Psalm 119. Let's look at Psalm 119 first. Before I was afflicted, I went astray. But now I keep thy word. Thou art good and doest good, and dost good, teach me thy statutes. You see that? Before I was afflicted, I went astray. What does it mean? To go astray, what does that mean? To go astray is to wander around away from God. Before I got addicted, I went astray. But now, I keep thy word. That's what this says. Psalm 19:67. And the whole psalm says hunger for word. Do you think there's a problem in the church about hunger for word?
Yes.
It's very obvious. Because if there's no hunger for word, this will be This class is packed with people. But there's no hunger program.
They are not paying attention.
They don't even want to spend time on it. That's why I admire those in the ministries, those who teach the word of God, because that's, we can't force people, that's the thing. You just have to keep proclaiming the word. Now, whether people get it, it's, unfortunately, it's their own affair. Because some people are just not interested. Even the time of Jesus. And look at those nuns. Look at those nuns who pray day and night for the conversion of the world. They were praying, and what are the people doing? They're going about their business, and they're not paying attention, and they're not interested. That's the fact. Go to New York. You got people going all directions. All directions. And who knows? That's why it's amazing. Whenever I'm in the city, I go close to any church. I enter the church from St. Peter's by the World Trade to the Franciscans in Herald Square, and many of them. It's like a world totally apart from the neighborhood. Go outside, and people are so busy going by their business, and they have no straight thought about God. And then go inside, you see a few people, and they have thoughts about God. So there's this hunger for the word of God. From them, we learn from the Jews. The Jews were 80 years in exile. They became hungry for the word of God. They were clamoring for it. Let's hear it. Take out the book, Ezra, and proclaim the word to us. What about you? What about me? Every day, if possible, we go to Mass and we hear the word of God proclaimed. And then, okay, there's hunger, so they proclaim the word. What about us, the recipients? We hear the word, right? And what do? Saturday before that, I went to Mass in another diocese, another church. And believe it or not, I saw people who were leaving the church after communion. Yeah. Not many, but some few.
Even here.
Of course, even here. There was one time I was giving communion. I gave communion, and the person walked straight out the door. Straight out the door.
Yeah, I have seen one son here too.
So, where's the hunger for the word? Where's the hunger? And some people, during homily, what do? They step out. They step out during homily, and when the homily is done, they come back. Where's the word? Where's the hunger for the word? And where's the hearing? Some people are so in a hurry to leave, they forget that there's time involved. There's a amount of time involved. This is a big book. It's a collection of books. It takes time to read this and even proclaim. So this too. Then there's hearing because it was proclaimed. And then there's honor for the word of God. How do we honor the word of God?
Follow.
That's the best. Follow, of course. When it's being proclaimed, what do we do? I see people talking, or sleeping, or not paying attention. But that happens. Those things happen. So honor for the Word of God, and then help unto the Word of God. Book of Acts, chapter 8, verse 30. To the right. Book of Acts, chapter 8, verse 30. Now when 40 years had passed, an angel appeared to him in the wilderness of Mount Sinai, in a plain of fire and bush. When Moses saw it, he wondered at the sight, and as he drew near to look, the voice of the Lord came. I am the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, and of Isaac, and of Jacob. So Philip went to him and heard him reading Isaiah the prophet, and asked, "Do you understand what you're reading?" And he said, "How can I unless someone guides me?" And he invited Philip to come and sit with him. Yeah. This guy, Philip, has uttered this very sensitive word. He says, how can I understand this unless someone helps me? What about us? Oh, I know the Bible. I don't need help. I don't need anybody to explain anything to me.
Not reading somebody
to explain that to. And see that, quoting Acts chapter 8, verse 30, it says, I need someone to explain things to me. That's how I can understand. It's in the Bible. Acts chapter 8, verse 30. So, and then, when we get the help, it has to be heartfelt. Hebrews chapter 4. So if you go to the right, Hebrews chapter 4. Command and teach these things. Let no one despise your youth, but set the believers an example in speech and conduct, in love, in faith, in purity. In love, in faith, in purity. Those three words. Love. Nothing, right? It's not leading the word. Alma was just telling a story about her own cousin. Her own cousin has never married. She's old, much older than she had a daughter. She had a daughter from her boyfriend, but the you know, those typical.
Yeah.
And this daughter is now grown and is married now and with children, okay? Now the mother, who is Amma's cousin, I don't know what happened, but she now has a boyfriend. And she wants to get married. And the daughter was so furious. She was so furious about that. And she said, so many kinds of things that are certainly sinful. Sinful. To the point that she says, I will never come back here, to the house where the mother is. I will never come back here unless you're in a casket. That's how furious she was. I couldn't believe there are people like that. How can you do that to your own mother? Your own mother who made the wrong decision, that's why you came into the world. And now she's married, she has family, she has children. But that's no reason to do that to your own mother.
She's not married, so she can marry any time.
She's old and she says she needs company. I understand that. She's never married anyway.
Yeah.
She has every reason to marry. Why am I saying this? Because we're talking about heeding the Word of God. Hearing the Word of God is one thing. Honoring the Word of God is another thing. Right? Feeling the Word of God in your heart is still another thing. And most of all, heeding the Word of God is totally different, another thing. In fact, there are three warnings in the Bible. If you don't heed, there's three warnings in the Bible. And those are all New Testament stuff. So let's go to Matthew 7, verse 26. And everyone who hears these words of mine and does not take them and does not do them will be like a foolish man who built his house upon the sand. You see that? Matthew chapter 7, verse 26. People who hear the word and not heed. The Bible calls them foolish. Imagine being called foolish. Mm-hmm. And then, Luke 12, 47. Go to the right. Luke 12, verse 47.
That servant who knew his master's will, but did not make preparations nor act in accord with his will, shall be beaten severely.
Imagine that. Imagine that. Let me see my translation. And that servant who knew his master's will, but did not make ready or act according to his will, shall receive a severe beating. Imagine that. Do you not heed? You'll be severely beaten. There's only one way to go. Create hunger for it. You You have to like to hear it, honor it, help unto it, seek help, hearken. You must put it in your heart, and most of all, heed. What does it mean, heed? Abide, follow, obey. Unless you want to be beaten severely. Not a very. No, you don't want that. And then John chapter 5, the next book to the right. Now, John chapter 5, verse 25 says, truly, truly I say to you, the hour is coming, and now is, when the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God, and those who hear will live. Wow. This brings us to the question of hearing. Hear the word. John 5:25. When the dead will hear the voice of the Son of God. How can the dead hear the word of God? What does that mean? How can the dead hear the word of God?
Those who are active.
Those who are dead in sin. Those who are dead in sin will hear the word of God and they will live. Because hearing the word of God is not just hearing, okay? Okay, I heard. No, that's not what it is. What does hearing the word of God mean? Listening? It's a translation issue. There's a difference between hearing and listening. There's a difference. When you go outside, you probably hear the wind. The wind blowing. Or you probably hear the cars passing by. Are you listening to them? No, you're not listening to them. But if someone is talking about you,
you will listen.
You want to listen. What is this person talking about before? You see the difference between hearing and listening? Hearing the word of God means you're listening in love. Very important quote. Listening in love. Because if you are listening for the wrong reason, that's not hearing the word of God. Remember, the name and the nature of God is love. So, in order to listen to the word of God, it has to be in love. In other words, to hear the word of God, you have to like to hear it. You have to like it. You cannot be forced to hear the word of God. There's no such thing. I remember in the, I'm not sure, I think it's at 11:30 Mass. I could hear the parents and the boy. Now you go to the side and dress up. And why don't and the mother was insisting, and then the boy, you know what the boy said? I don't want to go. He didn't want the servants an altar server, and he was being forced. You remember Father Wojciech calling those who want to be altar servers. There are only two requirements. Number one, you have had your first communion, and the second requirement is you are not forced to serve as altar server by your parents. Because some parents, they just want to see their children serve as altar boys. My two boys were altar servers. I am also Sometimes I'm of that habit of I have to be called. I have to be called in order to serve. But that's not a good attitude. A good attitude is, you know what? I'll go. I'll do it. This is it. You have to heed the word. Have you the idea how important this is? Very important. A lot of people just take it in stride. Well, they just take it in stride and they take care of it. It's all right, okay, that's the word of God. Now, this makes more sense when you take a look at this history, at how this hunger came about. It's because of the 80 years of exile in Babylon. Sometimes things happen and that wakes us up. Sometimes our loved ones, some of our loved ones will have to die before our eyes get open to something about God. Unfortunately for some, it is a negative effect. They walk away from God because of anger, because of absolute dislike, because they are not happy with what happened. They don't understand. Our lives are not ours. Do you realize that now? Our lives are not ours. Our children are not ours.
We don't own anything.
Everything is owed to God. Everything. Even my eyeglasses, I owe to God. I owe nothing. Truly. Okay, let's get to our study notes. You probably heard this last Sunday. The little phrase for last Sunday is bringing good news. Just exactly what good news is. What is good news?
The word of God is good news. The word of God is good news.
Okay.
Gospel.
Gospel. That's correct. What else? So you're saying here's the gospel? Somebody else there. There's nobody in here. You say gospel? What does the gospel mean? Good news.
That's the word of God.
The word of God. Are you ready? Good news is Jesus. The gospel. That's why Jesus says, I am the truth.
Yeah.
Because he is the gospel. I am the truth. It's just like saying, outside of me, there's no truth. That's why, how can you be not Christian? Because there's only one truth. There's only one truth. And his name is Jesus Christ. Outside of him, there's no truth. That's very clear. Book of John. this story, the Gospels tell us the truth about Jesus Christ, his life, his teachings, his death, his resurrection. He has personally become involved in human history. He has come to make a path to eternal union with the Father. We can thank our Lord for becoming man and strengthening the relationship between God and man. And look at the next one. We should read the Gospels with reverence and take seriously Christ's invitation to become his followers. That should be highlighted. Serious invitation to become Christ's followers. Unfortunately, there's way too many people. When they hear something like, Alleluia, Amen. And but look at the light. Glad tidings to the poor. Who are poor here?
Seniors.
Are you poor? What's the model? We all need his grace, friendship, and mercy. Our spiritual neediness is a source of blessings. Christ has come to enrich each of us with the presence of his love, the love of the Father for his children. Remember what I, two Thursdays ago, I was talking about, you invested too much for something you wanted, so much time, so much treasure, so much sacrifice. You were not eating outside, you were just a lot of the things that you had to forego just to get that thing. And when you get it, it seems so precious to you. You love it so much. Right? There's a saying, easy come, easy go. You heard that? If it comes so easy to you, you don't value it as much. You agree? That's why I tell the girls, don't give in too easily. Because the harder for them to get you, the more they value you. Although don't overdo it. So do I turn to him in confidence in my needs? If you're struck with a problem, anything, medical diagnosis, loss of job, or serious sickness in the family, what is your first tendency?
Pray.
Yes, pray. That's what I do. I've been blessed so far. All the schools I went to, they all have chapels. They all have chapels. USD has a chapel. UP has a chapel. UE has a chapel. Seton Hall has a chapel. And it's right next to our seminary. So before I go to my class, I go to the chapel first. I spend time. As much time until about 15, 20 minutes before the class, then I go to my class. And there's so much peace even sitting there and staring at him while he's staring at you. It's so peaceful and quiet. Very different feeling. And you totally ignore what's going on outside of chapel. It's totally ignored. When you're with the Lord, you could care less about anything else. Is that how you do it? It's such a good idea when you are in New York City. I love that place, the Franciscan, St. Francis, on 33 or 32? Somewhere there. It's by Madison Square Garden. It's so noisy, you got people walking all directions. You got people selling all kinds of stuff on the sidewalk. You got you hear the siren of the ambulance or the cops. But once you enter that, you see the you see St. Francis there kneeling. And then you go and you go inside. It's like heaven. It's different. You can feel the presence. Inside that church, any church, you can feel the presence. Number three, a year acceptable to the Lord. For 3 years, short years, Jesus walked among the people of Palestine. How many people really discovered him for who he was? How much time do we have to know the Lord? How much time do we have?
We don't have much time.
Our normal lifespan is about... now it's about 70... I think 76. 76 years. 76 years is not that long a time compared to eternity. So we only have 76 years to know him. Question is, do you? Do I? Do we really know him? Christ is present for the asking. Do I attempt to discover him more deeply each day? I like that. Christ is present for the asking. You see that?
Yeah.
Ask for him and he comes.
Yeah.
If you haven't experienced it, I strongly suggest ask for him right now. Ask for Jesus right now. He will come. Our prayer. He will come. He will dwell with you. Remember the prayer? Monday, there's Mark chapter 3, there's identity confusion. Remember what the Pharisees were saying? He's possessed by the devil. By the prince of demons, he drives out demons. That's in Mark chapter 3. Number one is not indifferent. What does it mean, not indifferent? What does it mean, not indifferent? It means different. Right? Double negative, you know, double negative. This double negative, not is negative. Indifferent is negative. What happens when it's a double negative? It becomes positive. Know that?
Yes,
in English grammar. So double negative become positive. So not indifferent means different. So with Jesus on earth, another world becomes evident. Evil spirits. Jesus has come to take control of the kingdom, and the devils are in a panic and begin to lose ground. In other words, Jesus is a threat to evil. His goodness, truth, and holiness are capable of putting the devils into submission. When Christ takes a stronger hold in my life, things begin to change. Do I let Christ challenge evil in my heart or in the world around me? What pertains to us here is, when Christ takes a stronger hold on our lives, do things change? Do things change? Yeah, definitely. Not one of them. Change is not evil per se. The change that Jesus brings is good, since he comes to put demons in their place, bringing about good. This awakening of the good worries the devil. So how do we this apply to us? Do I realize that facing difficulties is a sign of growth in Christian authenticity? That should be highlighted. How do you react in the face of difficulties? There are many difficulties. Can be financial, can be emotional, can be psychological, can be mental. But how do we respond to difficulties? That's the question here. And it says, facing difficulties is a sign of growth in Christian authenticity. In other words, you become a true Christian when you face difficulties. Do you know, it's such immature, there's so much immaturity when you don't face difficulties. It's part of life.
That means you're growing.
Exactly, you're growing when you face difficulties. What do some people do in the face of difficulties? They drink liquor.
Yeah.
Why are you drinking? So I can forget the problem. Baloney. So why? You make the problem worse by not thinking about it. Especially if you watch those dramas on TV. Somebody loses his job and what? It's okay, let's go drink. Will the problem go away? Of course not. You get worse. Do I realize that facing difficulties is a sign of growth in Christian authenticity? What is authenticity? You become a real Christian. Do you know that you will know who your friends are when you are down? It's not when you are way up. When you win the lotto, you have many friends.
And many relatives.
Are they your friends and relatives? Not in those times. Your real friends, you will know. Because when you're really down, and they're still with you, those are your real friends. In my life, one thing I can guarantee you is this. If there's a problem that God lets you onto, His graces will be enough to carry you through. His graces will be enough. So I always say to myself, God will take care of this. Personally, I don't know how to go through this, but God will. He will make a way. Exactly. Romans 8:28. Again, there's a greater plan. And for those who believe, it will all work out for the best. The only condition is you believe.
God knows better.
Third, only good. Think of the joy that people experience when Jesus freed them from the power of the evil one. Again, let's go down. Do I rejoice to have Christ as my friend? Do I try to listen to his teachings with a willing heart? Thankful for the chance I have to abide in God's heart by living the life of grace. Remember the song, What a Friend We Have in Jesus. Tuesday, Mark 3, Stronger Than Blood. Oh, Jesus, your mother and your brothers are waiting outside. They want to speak with you. They want to see you. What did Jesus say? Who are my brothers and my mothers? Anyone, he says, anyone who does the will of my Father is my sister, my brother, and my mother. Wow. Stronger than blood. In other words, if you want to be a child of God, which I assume you all are, if you want to be a child of God, you must do the will of the Father. So if you are not doing the will of the Father, don't pray the Our Father. Because you have no right to pray the Our Father. By calling God your Father, it presupposes that you So if you don't do his will, why call him father? Right? Anyone, he says, anyone who does the will of my father is my sister, my brother, and my mother. Tuesday, that's just Tuesday. Maybe he needs a break. Maybe he was tired, he was very busy. His mother arrived to give him a bit of food. You know how the kids are? I don't know if that happened to you. You know, when our kids are growing, you will know that they're growing when they start acting like they don't want to be seen by their classmates with you. They don't want to be seen. If you have to drop them, we used to drop them in Belleville, or sometimes we'd go fetch them. Okay, stop. Before they see their classmates, they want to get off and then walk. So they'll be alone when the classmates see them. Guess what? Jesus the same thing. Look at this. He has strengthened himself through intimate contact with the Father. Surely his mother was encouraged by what she found. Now, the question to you is this. Do I let the will of God be my strength? Does prayer transform me to the point where charity and evangelization become my natural way of being? Do I let the will of God be my strength? And then closeness for the right reason. People were naturally attracted to Jesus. Simply being physically close to him did not count. One had to open one's heart to receive his message of conversion. He was looking to transform people, to make them capable of living sons and daughters of God. Am I willing to learn Jesus' standards and act as he does? Then I can be close to him. He will allow me into his intimacy if I make God's will mine. That should be underlined. Make God's will mine. Remember my little advice to you all the time. Whenever you pray, you always include, if it be your will. That's the safest prayer there is. If it be your will. Just like the leper. Remember the leper? If you wish, you can make me clean. Two beautiful traits of a prayer. That's a perfect prayer. Number one, you don't impose. You don't order God, hey, heal me. You don't say that. And what you say, if you wish, you can make me clean. So number one, you don't impose. You don't order God. And number two, you have full trust in God. Because he's saying, if you only will, you can make me clean. In other words, you can do whatever you want. I have full trust in you. I know you can do it if you only wish. And that's why Jesus responded, yes, I will. I will that you be made clean. And he was. He was made clean. I always say that any group of people I speak before, I always say, when people ask you for a prayer to heal, for healing, do so, but always include, if it be God's will. If it be God's will, let the healing begin. Because it's possible that it might be God's will that the person dies. Like John. If it's God's will, he can be made well by God. Imagine that. Lord God, if it be your will. Nothing is impossible to God. Wednesday, work for the harvest. Number one, beware of the thieves. What the Father has planted in our lives is good. Goodness can bear fruit. If you watch the news, your mind will wander away from these lessons. It's hard to believe sometimes there are people who just became so callous and they don't feel any remorse. And they don't feel guilty whatsoever for all the evil that they do. There's so much evil in the world, and there's no remorse. They don't feel guilty. Those are the thieves. Because all of us have been created in the image and likeness of God. All of us. Including those criminals. Now, having said that, whatever God planted in our hearts is good. Whatever God planted in our hearts and our minds is good. But how can anybody lose sight of remorse, lose sight of guilt, and just do those evil things? Those are the thieves, according to Mark chapter 4. What about us? The devil tries to take goodness from our lives through enticing us with evil, filling our hearts with selfishness. Selfishness. Imagine if you own, have you met people who are so selfish, they just worry and care only about themselves, nobody else. Imagine that. We need to renounce Satan every day by fixing our will on the goodness of Christ. And there are two ways to do this: sincere prayer and generosity of spirit.